last time I concluded the talk with the lawsuit that was filed against Trump because of this executive order, which right there on the board. So we're talking about the Open Society for Justice executive order, pretty much said that this executive order right there, and it is based on International Emergency Economic Powers Act, in part, it is based also on other things, was the type of law which imposed sanctions on senior officials of international court. They imposed, pursuant to executive order, the sanctions were imposed against two individuals so far, to my knowledge. And but because many attorneys are working, so one of them was the prosecutor, the chief prosecutor, Fatou Bensouda, if I pronounce it correctly. And there was one other person. I do not see that person's name, but basically it got a lot of people upset, because especially a lot of attorneys here. So they went to court, obviously, and they effectuated the challenge, asking to enjoin the court, meaning declare the executive order, at least which the part that pertains the sanction part, to be illegal. As a, by way of background, real quickly, the administration got upset because International Criminal Court instituted an investigation of the alleged human rights violations committed by U.S. armed forces. I don't think they care much about other persons, but they were upset about even the allegation that U.S. Armed forces might have committed some kind of violation on the population within Afghanistan. And Afghanistan is a subscriber to the International Criminal Court. So they decided to issue this executive order saying that, okay, you undermine our national security pretty much. So the drama is still out there, but what I wanted to point out in this particular case were the stuff which are relevant to those who work especially in the area of exports, because the EAR, for example, the legal authority is based on the AIPA, on the stuff which are, so this is a complaint, it is dependent on the stuff which are which, for example, EAR, its authority draws from AIPA, from International Emergency Economic Powers Act. So one of the things which it's right here, which are being discussed in the complaint, which is currently in the district court, Southern District Court of New York, is the provisions of the AIPA, the International Emergency Economic Powers Act, which say, okay, so the president's, so what we do is, we're lawyers, pretty much. We go to the court, and we make arguments. We provide our opinions. We, yes, we are U.S. persons, but we also have, some of them are dual citizens of the other countries, such as Canada, for example. But basically, we go to court and we assist the court personnel, which is now under sanctions, in their legal work. And now we're afraid that the AIPA, which carries a criminal sentence up to 10 years, I think up to 10 years, will criminalize our assistance to the folks in the International Criminal Court by virtue of this executive order. In a way, they what their argument for comes to is it comes down to this section, which talks about that International Emergency Economic Powers Act cannot be applicable to the work that is done by attorneys, simply because whatever is being done, it's falls within the exception. So here is the codified version of the Emergency Economic Powers Act. The section that is being argued is 1702B1. So, exception to grant of authority. So, here it is. So, if you have, in other words, the president does not have authority to regulate or prohibit directly or indirectly any postal, telegraphic, telephonic, or other personal communication which does not involve transfer of anything of value. And also, of course, they talk about the paragraph 3, which does not only involve transfer of value, but the transfer of information, materials, so all this stuff that the lawyers do, and it doesn't matter if it's whether commercial or otherwise. So in other words, what's being done here is the argument is, listen, yes, we sometimes go there and do it pro bono, meaning that we don't charge anything. We do it as a service to the community, and sometimes we do it for money and for compensation. And this is still not the legal services is not the type of services which are envisioned by International Emergency Economic Powers Act. So that's the crux of the argument. So we even see this provision, this very influential provision, being played out right now as a director to the against the attorneys who are in the United States and who work with the International Criminal Court. So that was a kind of like a background introduction. I would like to dive into the AIPA. I don't think I have I have to cut short in about 10 minutes because of the of my I have to attend another event at 6:30. So I'll be cutting it short, but I wanted to pave the way. By now I really hope that I made a payway that of the importance of this particular law, the International Emergency Economic Power Act, as it applies to the to the international trade community, because it serves as an umbrella for the regime which regulates the flow of goods, mostly on the export side, but it can also be done on the import side, and even within the United States under the deemed export rule. So right now we're sitting here, we're talking about the AIPA and how it is used as a club against lawyers, how it is used as a club against international traders, right, who don't always follow the law. But in fact, if you look at the history of AIPA, if you look at the background, it was actually designed as a provision which limits the authority of the president. This is not something which is designed to really expand on authority of the president. So this is another one of those historical perspective of how far we have moved. So AIPA was enacted October 28, 1977. Later on, believe December, signed into the law by the president Jimmy Carter. And so we're talking about the 1970s. And what's useful here is to really understand the context within which Jimmy Carter enacted this particular provision, and the congressional attitude and the global attitude, which was prevalent at the time. So, Jimmy Carter signed this the this AIPA into law in 1977. The next year, he goes to China, and he establishes normalized relations with China. Of course, this is something which we're all very much aware under the trade war rubric, which Donald Trump is trying to undo. The only problem with that, well, it's not really a problem, it's an irony, right? So, 1979 is also the year which China domestically changed a lot of its own laws. It's pretty much, it made many things different. And one of them was the establishment of special economic zones. I think one of the first was the Guangdong province. And then it kept on expanding, expanding, expanding. If we go to the Department of Commerce, they have a balance of trade. We can see from 1979 it was virtually nothing, but then it kept on rising, 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 meaning that imports kept on coming, kept on coming until what we have today. Today is essentially, well, specifically for consumer goods, if we go to any department store, we pretty much see everything made in China, right? So Jimmy Carter enacted the law which is being used to as a tool against China. But at the same time, he enacted the provision which was he at the same time he normalized relations, he established the diplomatic relations which were paved way by his predecessor, President Nixon, and the ping pong diplomacy. Me and Ken, we deliberated on this a lot because we thought that when we were talking about the Bretton Woods and the global order, we thought we needed to make a lecture on China, and now I feel like we need to go to this again because China keeps creeping up and creeping up whenever we talk about the international trade. But fine, it's so China, well, China is lurking in the background. What we have is we have authorization of this AIPA law, and I think it would be useful to talk to take a little glance at the legislative history that paved the way to the AIPA. So this is a Senate report deliberations that took place right on the International Emergency Powers Act that kind of paved the way to the law. And here is here's the congressional record, talks about the purpose of the bill. And it goes on to say the purpose of the bill is to revise and delimit the president's authority to regulate international economic transactions during war or national emergencies. So in other words, to cut them down. This is in response to two developments. Number one, presidents of emergency authority under Trading with the Enemy Act of 1917 to regulate domestic and international economic transactions, unrelated to the declared state of emergency. And number two is to safeguard for the role of the Congress in declaring and terminating national emergencies. So those are the reasons. Those are the pretty important reasons, because one kind of have to look back at the historical context of why the 1977 senators in 1977 think so conservatively about president being able to do what the president wants. One of the things, and this requires us to really go into the trading with the Enemy Act of 1917, because that particular Trading with the Enemy Act would shed the light on what took place, and under the rubric of the Trading with the Enemy Act, and what were the concerns of the senators. So I'm going to pull up an article, because I think it sufficiently describes what's going on with the Trading with the Enemy Act. As the act itself, the name of it suggests, it was enacted in 1917 in anticipation of the involvement in World War One. Right? The original act was intended to grant the president discretion, a broad authority to regulate foreign transactions. However, the act itself also involved certain things which were applied domestically. So the Trading with the Enemy Act was used against states that were declared enemies, and from 1933 to 1977, the year of congressional deliberations, it was also used in situations not involving declared war. So this is the key here. The key here is to really point out that the situations that do not involve declaration of war need to be under the better check of the United States Congress. And this is why you have the enactment in part. This is why you have enactment of AIPA. I want to give one example, and I think we're going to close here and continue on with this conversation the next stream. But basically, I'd like to fast backward into the 1933. So back then we had President Roosevelt, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, FDR. And what FDR has done is he made an executive order, specifically executive order 6. Let me see. This is a bad copy of the order. But here what we have is Executive Order 1602. So what that executive order, so the basis for the order, the premises for the order were the Trading with the Enemy Act of 1917. And under the rubric of the act, the president issued executive order which mandated all Americans to surrender their gold. And the gold had to be surrendered at a certain price, which is $20.67 per troy ounce. And those who wouldn't surrender, those folks would be considered criminals. So there were criminal penalties, just like under AIPA, 10 years. There was certain exceptions, so like a small jewelry, rings, earrings, stuff like that. But basically, if you had your savings in gold, you had to surrender them at a fixed price. And as soon as this expropriation took place, the price immediately was fixed up to $35 per ounce. So that didn't go well with a lot of people. I spoke to some old timers in person, and this was one of the things many of them, several generations have passed, they still hold a grudge upon FDR. So this is something which was of a significance. So the congressman, going back to the deliberations by congressman of 1977, which were talking about the purpose of the bill, back then more closer obviously to 1933 gold expropriation, which is domestic issue. This doesn't deal with the wartime era. There was a huge economical downturn. There were issues with poverty. There were issues with starvation. The country was in the midst of depression. But nevertheless, those thoughts that the president under that authority can confiscate the gold of all the American people was something which was in mind and reflected in the report. Let me see. If I scroll down, I think I will have this statement. So the senators say this section would exclude from the president's emergency authority of regulation or prohibition of. Well, this is the one that we talk about, which is playing out in the courts right now under that International Criminal Court rubric. I know that they also had a statement. No, I don't see it right now, but they had a statement where they explicitly say that it has been used domestically in 1933, and we are not happy with that. So this is something. Oh yeah, right here. I just didn't highlight it. So they decided it was designed to cope with the banking crisis, of course. But basically, this is something which senators were concerned with, and this is something which paved the way to the enactment of the International Emergency Economic Powers Act, which is still with us today. For many of us who deal with international trade regulation, we know that the effect of the act, for example, regulations that deal with SDN list, the counter narcotic trafficking sanctions, non-proliferation sanctions. Well, this is it used to be the agreement, not anymore. All these things were done under the authority of AIPA. International Emergency Economic Powers Act is huge to the to us if freight forwarders, customs brokers, licensed customs brokers, lawyers. The International Economic Emergency Power Act comes into play when we deal with the export of the commodities from the United States, and because it is a legal umbrella for the international IEER, for the dual purpose goods. It is umbrella for the commerce country list and laws administered by the Bureau of Industry of Security under the Commerce. So this is something that we're going to focus next stream, as we kind of saw the background of AIPA, and we will see how historically it starts to play out by placing some not so diligent exporters in prison, and putting others on guard.